We're on to the last set of sections here in terms of the informed consent process. And I know you guys have had quite a few elements talking about the importance of informed consent for clinical trials. Again, this just needs to be detailed in your protocol as to how you're going to protect the safety of participants. How are you monitoring for adverse events? Who do you have to inform if there is a serious adverse event? If you're getting routine labs, well, what if you have an important finding that you find, you know, somebody's glucose is extremely elevated all of a sudden? Who needs to be notified? Do you have permission to notify that individual? Did you get the participant's permission to tell their physician about it? Those kinds of details, if you're collecting that information, you need to have a plan of how you're going to handle it if those situations come into play. The other aspect of this that we're seeing more and more now is the importance of either a data safety monitoring board for large clinical trials or a smaller independent monitoring committee for smaller trials. I stress the word independent. This group should be able to make a recommendation as to whether the study is going to be able to complete or not, or whether the study has really gotten to a place where there's just no way this is going to be done and maybe we should shut things down and not enroll participants and make promises that we're going to learn from their participation when there's no way we'll ever get to the full number of participants that we need for a trial. So the independence is really important. You wouldn't want to have the person making that recommendation that their job is, you know, that they report to the PI of the study. You really do want there to be some independence from that the group. And in general, these individuals are making recommendations to the funding agency. So at NCCIH, we get summaries and recommendations from these groups as to whether or not the study should continue and if there's any recommended changes to help the study get back on track if they're far behind on their accrual or their recruitment. You want to include in your protocol how you will modify the protocol and how you will get those modifications approved. At NIH, we do have certain protocol changes do require permission from NIH before you make those changes. If, for example, you're now enrolling a group of patients who are at higher risk, you certainly would want to get, you would need to get NIH permission to do that. If you're adding an arm to a study and doing a whole new intervention as part of your study design, you certainly need to get NIH permission. And there's policy information available about when protocol changes rise to the level that they actually need NIH permission before they're made. In addition to that, when do you need to get your IRB to approve the changes that you've made in your protocol or consent forms that you're working with should be specified in your protocol so that when it comes time to do it, you know how to do it and you're not stuck with, oh no, we didn't write that down, now what do we do? So I'm gonna conclude with you want to write the protocol so anyone can replicate the study. That's your real goal here, is that this makes it transparent and clear and possible for someone else to reproduce the study. There have been many attempts to reproduce other studies. A whole series of those were just published in the psychology literature. And many of those studies, they were unable to reproduce the findings that were found in the original studies. Part of those challenges were that the specifics were not detailed enough in the protocol, and those were only attempts to replicate studies that had protocols, let alone the studies that didn't even have protocols, and are, all you have are just the primary publication to try to replicate the study itself. The nice thing about a protocol, if you don't need the more detailed version of the MOP, is that you have a one-stop document that meets all of your needs for the study from beginning to end. And it includes all the changes and all the things that you would do to update it over time. The last thing you want is, oh, well, the procedure for that is over in that binder, and the procedure for this is over in that binder. You want it all in one place so that it's easy to find and people can consistently adhere to the protocol and make sure that it's delivered the way that it was intended. So in conclusion, you want to make sure that the document actually makes sense. sometimes we get protocols and in one section it says they have 100 participants, and in another section it says that they have 200 participants, and in another section it says that they have 150, and we are so confused and don't know. In one section it says that there's two arms to the study, and the next section says that it's three arms of the study. So the consistency across it is really important. And in working with these documents, you do, if you're the primary person that's making all of these edits and all of these changes, you do get to a point where it's really hard to kind of see the forest for the trees kind of scenario. And so having someone independent who sees participants, to have them read the study flow and make sure that this is something I could do if you gave it to me, can be really helpful when you finish your protocol, to have someone else take a look at it. You want to make sure that you have adequate staffing to actually pull this off, that you can actually implement the protocol. It's practical. And really importantly is the rigorous aspect of this. So we're learning more and more about how important it is to, you know, as much as you can, you know, if it's possible to randomize participants and have a good control group and to have blinded assessors do the evaluation if you have an intervention that can't be blinded. There are many things you can do to improve the quality and the rigor of the data that you're collecting. And if you detail that in the protocol, you'll have better data in the end and less potential for bias in your results. And what it always comes back to is, did you define the hypothesis that you wanted to test? And did you design your study to be able to answer that question? And did you collect the data so that you can actually analyze it and test your hypothesis? That's always what it comes back to. And we get caught in the weeds of, well, what if we do this and what if we do that? And we often lose the concept of, what is the hypothesis that I want to test? And does this protocol allow me to do that? So with that, I'll just remind you that the public comment period is still open for the draft protocol. So they are accepting public comments up through April 17th. The last few slides that are here are resources, which you've probably seen before, but they're certainly great references about clinical trials and other elements and different pieces. Information, I think you've heard about REDCap and the Assessment Center. The one that I wanted to point out here is this first bullet here. This is the website on slide 55. This is the website to get to those draft protocols, so that you do have that there in the slides so that you can find them. You can also certainly search by the notice number that's there in your slides, but I did provide the URL there for everybody so that you could find it. So with that, I will see if there's questions in the room. I know I've gone for a while and been talking at you all, but I really appreciate your guys' interest in learning more about clinical trials. It is sometimes a daunting process, but we try to provide toolboxes and information so you don't have to create this from scratch, that you can use templates and find instructions to help you in putting this information together rather than trying to think of it all on your own. And the one other thing that I should mention is, depending on what institution you are at, your institution may have a required template that you use for your protocol. Here at NIH, we accept any template at the current time, I should say, with the current public comment. We'll see what happens for IND and IDE studies. But we do ask that you double check it against our template just to make sure that it includes all of the necessary elements, so there's no missing pieces in what you submit to us. But we do accept protocols from other institutions. And the last thing we ever want to have happen is that we at our institution have this protocol and this is we have a different version that we send to the NIH, because they never match. And at NIH, we don't know what's actually happening on the ground, and we don't know which protocol is being followed. There should be a single protocol that everybody uses for a given study.